made one. This one. This is the first regression model, which includes all the population, excluding only the hospital-specific variables. Here you can see that being a male, socioeconomic status, and dissatisfaction with the primary healthcare services were the three of them were significantly associated with an increase in the satisfaction levels, and only waiting time to undergo annual medical tests was associated with a decrease in the satisfaction with the health component of the social package. Now, coming to the multivariate linear regression model of satisfaction with the hospital services, including those who have used hospital services. So you see that making payment to hospitals was associated with a dramatic decrease in the satisfaction, while all the other, like the previous model, made socioeconomic status satisfaction with the hospital services were associated with an increase, and also education level, as the education level increases, also the satisfaction level increases. Now, the main findings of our study was the following. We saw an improvement in utilization of preventive and primary healthcare services, and there was a high awareness of beneficiaries about their rights and services covered by the social package, and out-of-pocket payments within the scope of the social package hasn't been fully resolved yet. Making payments and long waiting times were associated with a decrease satisfaction. Now, like any other study, this study also had its limitations and strength. The limitations were that this was confined only to Yerevan city and to only one beneficiary group, which were the public school employees. And the absence of a comparison group or a baseline measurement limits our ability to compare our results and see if there was any big change. And the strength of our study was that this was the second attempt of evaluating the health component of the social package, but this was the first through a quantitative assessment. Now, here are the following recommendations that we'd like to make. The first one is to include the outpatient procedures provided by hospitals into the benefit package, expand the list of inpatient services covered with the health component of the social package, increase the number of drugs supplied within hospitals, cover within the scope of the health component of the social package additional consultations, laboratory and diagnostic tests for those with identified health problems during the annual medical tests, increase healthcare worker compensation to eliminate incentives for informal payments, and reduce the waiting time for the annual compulsory medical tests. So, thank you. Be healthy and be happy. If you have any questions, I would gladly answer them.
Congratulations, Reg, great presentation. My question is related to your recommendations. Would you please go to... Okay. Could you explain, please, why do you suggest to include outpatient procedures provided by hospitals into the package?
Okay, so outpatient procedures, which, like, for example, if the patient is not hospitalized within the hospital, it is not covered within the scope of the social package. So in order to make it more accessible and to prevent out-of-pocket payments, it is advisable to include the outpatient procedures as well into the hospitals. And the incentives for hospitalizing, it exceeds in this case, since it is not covered, the outpatient procedures are not covered by the social package, so the providers have more incentive to hospitalize the patients, making crowding and inefficiencies. Thank you for your question.
Okay, I have a question. Could you please clarify why did you have two multivariable linear regressions? Mm-hmm. Clarify that there are already.
So the reason behind me having two linear regression models was that the hospital-specific questions, or the variables which were hospital-specific, had very limited amount of people who answered to these questions. When I included those variables into my model, it dramatically decreased the number of my observations, making it hard to generalize my findings.
So what about the first one? What does it explain?
The first one explains the whole population without any deliberately excluding anyone. It includes everyone which had undergone the yearly the annual compulsory medical tests, including those who have used hospital services, so the it covered all the population.
Thanks for the presentation. I had a question. I wonder about the strategies of final model development, and I would like to know whether you tested for the collinearity.
Yes. So my final models were designed in this fashion. So at first, a simple linear regression was done. And all those factors or variables which were found to be statistically significant with my outcome variable, which was the satisfaction score with this, with the social package, they were included into the final models. Did I answer your question?
Collinearity.
For the collinearity, yes, collinearity, the variance inflation factor analysis was done, and the maximum amount that I found was 1.86, which is in the range. And so there was no collinearity.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Raja. This is a very important study, and I think you should receive the attention of the Ministry of Health.
Thank you.
For being the nearest future. I have the following question. You, if I understood it correctly, you found that satisfaction was significantly associated with education level of your respondents in multivariate analysis. So how do you explain the association?
According to the literature, educational level is associated with the satisfaction with the, any healthcare system. There are some people who say that it's not associated, but the ones that I have found and seen that they are associated with the increase in satisfaction. Here in Armenia, I know that where the previous studies have found that the lower the education level, the more satisfied people are due to their less expectation, or their they do not expect much from the. But in other countries, the studies have shown that people with lesser education level are more skeptic about the healthcare that they receive, especially with the healthcare providers. They are more dissatisfied with the healthcare providers, namely doctors or nurses. So this aspect is associated with the decrease in satisfaction.
My next question is, did you ask reasons for dissatisfaction? I mean, those who were dissatisfied, did you ask them?
No, the questions were formulated in this manner, that there were 10 questions regarding the satisfaction, and in general, the health component of the social package from 1 to 5 on a scale, they would rate, but no question was asked why is the reason for you to be dissatisfied or satisfied.
Because as far as I remember, you had one general question, right?
Yes, there was one general question.
There was one, and also there was a scale.
The score, yes.
But can you elaborate on this? You didn't ask why they were dissatisfied, but you asked something else. What you asked, what were the main responses?
I have asked about the impact score, that how to improve, yes, sorry. I have asked about how to improve the social package, and the main three suggestions that they have made was, in my recommendations, to include the outpatient procedures, to increase the drug supplies, and to increase the inpatient procedures covered by the social package. These were the three main suggestions made by the beneficiaries.
Thank you for the presentation. I have a question about one of your recommendations when you are recommending to increase the rewarding mechanisms of physicians in order to reduce the out-of-pocket payments. When you were asking about out-of-pocket payments to the respondents, did you have reasons for that? Were they mentioning?
Yes.
What kind of findings do you have?
The reasons were as such that the main participants said that the question was as follows, like, whom did you pay to doctors, for example, and what was the reason for paying to doctors, like, for example, the hospital required, the doctor required, the nurse required, the cleaning lady required, or others specified. The majority of the participants who mentioned that they have paid to the doctor, almost most of them, they said that it was a requirement by the doctor. So this makes it clearly an an official payment.
Okay, that's my last question. How would you explain the high proportion of female in your sampling? Is it related to your sampling technique or?
Since this study was conducted in schools, and as we know that the majority of the workers at schools are females, the teachers are mainly females, that is why they constitute the major part of my study.
Okay. I have a suggestion for the paper. Please look at the actual percent of females, female teachers working in public schools.
Mm-hmm.
Probably you can find that information on the website. So, and you can check whether this was a representative sample.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Inessa is our next speaker. Inessa Chilingarian.
Hi dear colleagues, dear friends and guests. Today I'm going to present you my thesis project, which is titled Risk Factors of Urinary Stone Disease in Armenia. It's a case control study. First of all, I will show some background information, our study aim and research questions. So we'll go through our methodology, our findings. We'll discuss our findings and make some conclusions and recommendations. And if you have questions, please ask them during the question and answer session. So what urinary stone disease is? It's a condition which is characterized by the presence of stones and calcification within the urinary tract. It's mainly diagnosed by ultrasound examination and computed tomography. And there are several ways of treatment, like pharmacological, extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy, and urology techniques, and open surgery. And all these techniques are used in Armenia. So urinary stone disease is the third most common urological disease worldwide, with the reported increase in prevalence.